So let's get started. Welcome to today's lecture. Just in general, as we are very few people now, I really encourage you to interrupt me at any point if something is unclear, because like it doesn't really make sense to speak to you otherwise, right? So So today's topic is statistical modeling. So this is probably the most theory-heavy lecture we will have at all, but I hope it will show you some like intuitive ideas about statistics, and that you will be able to understand a few things that might have been unclear, or at least were unclear to me before I really did this lecture for the first time. So what we have done until now, we did a lot with data, right? We learned how to transform data, how to visualize data, how to organize data in the right way. But what we didn't do until now is to try to describe the structure that underlies the data. So what we would ideally like to do is to find the general structure that generated our data, and by this generalize beyond the samples that we observed, so and make some statement about the general process that generates the data. So, and this is exactly what modeling is. You try to find some structure, the model, and some parameters, and together they should describe the data in a good way. And the choice of the model is something that you usually make explicitly, where you say, okay, I believe this is a good model for my data, and then you have some automatic algorithmic procedure to fit parameters of the model to the data. So, and I would distinguish here two main branches of at least data-driven modeling. So also there are like mathematical models where you just like try to find out the exact equation that describes, but if you do a data-driven, I would say there are two main approaches. One is machine learning, where you say, okay, I have some data, I split it into a training and a test set, and then I fit on the training set the parameters, and then I evaluate the generalization performance on the test set, so on data that was not used to fit the model. And by this I can say, okay, my model fits the data this and this well. And the other type that we will look in today is statistical modeling. So you could also say this is statistical learning, this is maybe more explicit modeling, whatever. Sometimes they even have the same model, so, but the approach is a bit different. We say, okay, instead of splitting the data, I use all the data to fit the parameters. Then I have to check that some assumptions that I made for using the model are in fact correct, and then I'm free to interpret my parameters in some way. So, and on the application side, I would say machine learning is probably more popular, because you don't really have to care so much about like statistical assumptions, whatever, you just throw it on the data, you get some model back, and either it works or not. But for the scientific use case, I would say that statistical modeling is still like the major thing, because you want to really be able to interpret your parameters and say, okay, after looking at the data, I say I observed an effect or so, and not just say, okay, I can fit now a model, but this doesn't really tell me anything. So when we do statistical modeling in Python, there's a package called StatsModels that has all the statistical models. While there are really a lot of models in StatsModels, we will look at one particular model today that is linear regression. That is probably also the simplest one, but that should allow us to understand the general concepts, and as the syntax or the interface of the models in StatsModels is very similar, you should also be able to use more complex models after understanding linear regression. So let's first start with what linear regression is, in fact. So the linear regression model, or the linear model, would look like something like this. We have data that we observe. This is our y here. Then we have some predictors that should predict the data. And then this is our design matrix x here. And then we have some parameter vector beta here. And by calculating the product of the predictors and the parameters, we should get our data back plus some error term, epsilon, here. And the assumption that we made, I don't know why this looks like this. Okay, anyway, the assumption that we make is that this error term, this epsilon, comes from a normal distribution with mean zero and a fixed variance. So we should say, okay, after fitting our linear model, only white noise, so to say, only Gaussian noise should be left, but the main structure in the data should be captured by this model. And so this also, in other terms, this means as much, maybe I can, I don't know, who of you already did the neuroinformatics lecture? No one? Or one? Okay, then you might have seen this graph probably. it's from this famous machine learning book by Bishop, but what you basically do, you have your y variable that you want to predict and your x, and then you have some data points, and then you like you fit a line through, that's a linear regression. But now when you ask for a new data point and say what is the most probable data point at x, what you don't really say, or what a linear model doesn't say, is that it will be exactly this value here that like s matches here. But what it will instead say is that, okay, I believe that this data point will come from a normal distribution that is centered at this point. So you can draw something like this here, right, and say, okay, given this x, I can tell you as much that the new data point will be drawn from a Gaussian distribution centered at this point. And to illustrate this, I have some code here. So what do we do here? We have a simple linear model with three parameters, the intercept, the slope, b, and then the fixed variance with a default parameter. And then we have a predict method where we say, okay, give me an x, and then I will predict y values for that x, and I will then put the density of this distribution on a fixed range, and then we have some code to plot the prediction. So this is, let's just look at this. So what we do here, we instantiate the model with like intercept 1 and slope 1. Then we make some x values. We gather all the predictions, and then we plot the predictions. So a model of like slope 1 and intercept 1 would generate a probability density, a two-dimensional probability density that looks something like this. So this is, so to say, what the linear model looks afterwards. So, and we can see how these parameters influence the model. So if we make the slope a bit steeper, you see that this line goes a bit up. If we make the slope negative, we will see that we don't see so much anymore because now it's all down here. So we, if you make the intercept a bit larger, then the whole line just moves up. Well, and if we change the implicit sigma parameter, so make it maybe a bit smaller, then we will see that the predicted probability distribution gets much sharper. So this is in fact what a linear model, so to say, how you can interpret a linear model. Yeah. Okay, so now let's really, what we do not want to do is just like pass some fixed parameters to a linear model, but we want to fit the model based on data. So let's first generate some data. What we do here, so the approach that we will take is we will use a linear model with fixed parameters to generate data from it, and then we will use a fitting procedure and see if we can recover the parameters of the original model afterwards. So we draw like 100 samples, we say our intercept should be 5, our slope should be 2, then we make some x values linearly spaced, then we draw from a normal distribution for the number of samples, just by default it will be mean 0 and standard deviation 1. So this is our noise, and then we just write down this term for the linear model where we say intercept plus x times slope plus noise, and then we save this into a data frame, and then we can plot the data, and this is how it looks. So given that we have a linear model that generates the data, this is how data could look like. So we see data is very close, or like moves along a line, but obviously not all points are on the line because of the random noise. So how could we fit a linear model to this data? We'll first start by doing the manual way, and then I'll show you how you can make this a lot easier using stats models. So what you have to do to fit a linear model, you first have to make a design matrix, and then you can use the so-called pseudo-inverse. So this is really given proper treatment also in the neuroinformatics lecture, so we really have no time to go into why this works now, because that would really take the entire lecture. However, the idea is, or the idea should be, that, well, we want to minimize the errors between like all the points and the line that we fit. And it turns out that given the assumption of a Gaussian noise, that this in fact minimizes the error terms, or like minimizes the squared error, which is the right way to calculate the error given this assumption. So for now, I think like you probably if you don't know this yet, you cannot understand this just from that, but the takeaway should just be that there is like a way to write down a formula to find the best solution. So no numeric, so there's a closed form solution, no numeric optimization is really necessary to find the solution. So you don't have to iterate or, I don't know, do gradient descent or whatever. You just write down this formula and then you get the solution. So as I said, we first have to make the design matrix. So given that we want to fit an intercept and a slope, we need a design matrix with two columns with the size of our predicted values. And then in the first column, we would put just ones because we fit a fixed intercept, so there should always be the same value. And then the slope should always be multiplied by x, so we put the value of x here. So this is how the first 10 values of our design matrix could look like. Then we write down a function called pseudo-inverse, which takes the design matrix and applies exactly this formula that we have here, t transpose in t, inverse in t transpose. So using this matrix multiplication operator here, lets us write down this very concisely, and then we can just say pseudo-inverse of design matrix gets us the pseudo-inverse, which has a shape of 2 times 100 after we had 100 data points. And what we now just have to do, we multiply the y values with the pseudo-inverse and we get back our parameters. So this is beta, and looking at this, okay, we get back two values as expected, 5.2 and 1.97. So given that the original values were 5 and 2, we see that this is pretty close and that the procedure worked and we could almost recover the original parameters. And when we plot the line parameterized by these parameters, here in red is the original and in blue is the original, in red is one recovered after fitting the model, we see that these lines also almost overlap, and this is what we expected. However, this is a bit tedious if we always have to specify our design matrix like this and then write a function for doing the pseudo-inverse ourselves. So there are ways to automate it, and the first automation tool is called PATSY. So PATSY is a tool that generates design matrices for you based on formulas. Well, this is happening now. Einfach das Ding hier. Okay. Ah, this froze again. Okay. Well, let's see if this comes back to life at any point. Time. Otherwise, you just have to watch the lecture on Binder and I try to talk to it and you tell me where you are looking at. Okay, now. It's just making noise, but not giving any visual output. Yeah, well, while this is turning on, I'll just continue talking. So we're just talking about PATSY. So this generates design matrices from so-called formulas. So formulas also come from the R world, where you can use this directly as part of the language. In Python, these are just embedded as strings and then parsed internally. Seems like it's coming back. Yeah, great. Okay. And yeah, formulas usually look like this. You have the endogenous or the predicted variable, so the variable that you want to predict on the left side. Then you have a tilde sign, and then you have the exogenous variable from which you want to predict this variable on the right side. So given writing down this means as much as I want to predict endogenous from exogenous, or I want to predict x from y. And inside these formulas, you could also, you can use, or you can refer to a lot of things. You can refer to columns of a data frame. You can refer to variables from the global namespace, or to special Patsy functions, or to other valid Python functions. However, we will just keep it plain and just use columns of a data frame. So what you would do to generate design matrices, you would call the Patsy D matrices function, passing the formula as a string first. We say we want to predict x from y. So we write x tilde y, and then we pass data. And we know data has both the columns x and y, so these will be resolved to these respective columns from the data frame. And then we get back to return values, first a design matrix for y, and then a design matrix for x. So a design matrix for y, I can do this, is just has the values of y. There might be other cases when you're doing more complex models where this would look different, but in most cases it will be just y. And you get back this design matrix object, but in fact this is just a numpy array with some nice string formatting. And you then also get this for x, and this is already named intercept and x, and you see the values here. And then we can simply right away do pseudo inverse of x design matrix. We can also say like y times y design matrix, and we get back the same parameters that we got back before. So this already freed us from having to specify the design matrix manually. However, since we wouldn't like always like to do this, we can further automate now using stats models. So you import stats models.api as SM, so this is the way you refer to stats models. And then the stats models module has different models as classes. So the simple linear regression is termed OLS in capitals, which stands for ordinary least squares. And this is because stats models comes from the econometrics community, and well, I hope this doesn't go like this for the rest of the lecture now. Yeah, while this is, so you all have the lecture on Binder. Okay, then I just continue, and I hope from what I will say you can infer for where I am, and I will just restart when it's up again. So, and yeah, this comes from the econometrics community, and like these people refer to linear regression as OLS for some reason. However, yeah, it shouldn't really matter for us. So how we use it, we pass the Y design matrix, so to say, as to the endogenous variable, and the X design matrix to the exogenous variable. Then we get back like a model, and we can call fit on this model. And then we get better fit object or result wrapper or something. And then we can call summary on this fit object. So, and what you should see then is that, just wondering if I now just switch this. Yeah, what you should, what you should get back is however, for most stats models, there's even a more convenient way that we will also use throughout the rest of the lecture to fit models, and this is the so-called formula API. So instead of just importing statsmodels.api, you import statsmodels.formula.api, as SMF in this case, and then for all the uppercase classes, you have lowercase functions where you can pass the formula and the data directly, and internally, what will happen, as you can imagine, is stats models we call Patsy, and we'll ask it to generate a design matrix, and we'll then pass it to its own model classes. So this is really the quickest way to fit a statistical model in Python, and then we can directly call fit summary and get the same result as before. So for the first exercise now, we will look at the tips data set. So the tips data set contains information about how much tip people gave in restaurant or like after a restaurant visit. And so it contains the amount of tip and then some features that could determine how much tip people would give. So how big the bill was in total, the gender of the people who ate there, if they were smokers, which day it was, how many people sat on the table, and so on. So your task would be now to use any of the methodologies I showed you above. You could, of course, choose the most convenient one to fit a linear model to this data and try to explain the amount of tip given based on the total bill. Yeah, so try this out. And yeah, I'll come back to you in 5 minutes or ask questions if you feel stuck.
Okay, like, are people still working on this? Okay, so I guess, like,
shouldn't take you too long, so we can stop this right now. By the way, because I just recently learned this, as II is actually doing the, like, pressing the I key twice is actually doing keyboard interrupt in Jupyter Notebook. That's very useful. So let's look at the solution. Well, we have, like, we make a regression saying we want to predict tip from total bill. We pass the tips data, we call fit on it, like, after passing it to OLS. Then we look at the summary. Okay, and we get some values back, and we will, yeah, we can now do this. By the way, if you continue to execute the stuff and you rename this fit, then probably the other cells will not work as expected, so you should execute this again so that you have the right variable called fit. So now we can fit a linear regression in Python very easily in just like two lines, and we get back a big table, and this makes us look very professional, right? So we can now say, okay, we fitted the data, and we can now say we got an F statistic of 203.4. However, we don't really have any idea of what these values mean. So this is what the rest of the lecture will be about, understanding the result that we get from doing this linear regression. So at first, let's focus on the table in the middle here. Yeah, so the first thing that we will talk about is effect size. So usually when you maybe hear statistics literature, people start with a p-value, say, okay, I got a p-value below 0.05, so my result is I found something. So however, what you should really start with when interpreting data in a statistical sense, you should start with the effect size, and really the p-value should be put last. However, what has any one of you an idea what the effect size might be? Or what it is, maybe. Okay, yeah.
It describes how strong
it is. Yeah, exactly. So this is really the point. So when looking at a linear regression, we can access the parameters of the fit just using fit.params, the intercept and the x. So exactly this would be the effect size, so to say, in this case of x. So if you, it depends on what you actually measure. So if you measure the difference between distributions, then the effect size would be just the difference between the distributions. If you interpret it in terms of linear regression, then the effect size of, like, the effect size of total bill is, or not of total bill, because it's now the fit from above, and we just set 2 as the parameters, is in fact 2. So this means as much as for each increase in x of unit 1, we get an increase in y of unit 2. So this is the effect that we have. So on whether an effect is worth reporting totally depends on the units that you measure on, and also the domain that you measure in. So if you have if you find that a substance contributes to catching a terminal illness or so, then maybe even a small effect might be very important. But if you, I don't know, try to estimate whether, like, changing your keyboard layouts lets you write an essay faster or so, and afterwards you find out that very consistently you save 5 seconds when you write, like, a 5-hour essay, then maybe it's not really worth to change the keyboard layout. So you really should estimate, interpret this, and do not just, like, blindly look on is it statistically significant, but really before looking at statistical significance, you should think about significance of the effect. So if the effect itself is insignificant, so why should we care to talk about it? Okay, then the next is explained variance. So you can find the explained variance here on the top. It's called R squared. And but explained variance is actually a better term, I would say, than, because no one can imagine something by the name R squared. And the explained variance can be seen as a standardized effect size, so to say, and it describes how much variance is explained away by the model, so how much variance is left after fitting the model. And the way you calculate it is simply you have 1 minus the variance of the residuals divided by the variance of the original predicted variable. So what are these residuals? These are simply the predicted values minus the observed values, so the absolute difference between, or not the absolute difference, just the difference between the predicted and the observed values, so how much is left after you subtract what the model predicted, so to say. And the way you can think about this is by looking at this plot. So this is like the data before we fit the model. So we have now our data here, and then on the marginals we have the histogram of the single variable. So the histogram of x is just uniform because we sampled it, or like we constructed it in this way, and then these values are a bit skewed, but in fact just also uniformly distributed here. So now after we use the residuals here, you can access them by fit.resid, or you can also calculate them afterwards. The data looks like this. So if you only look at the residuals here, then still the x value has the same distribution, but now the distribution of the y values got very small. And now if you compare the variance of this distribution to the variance of this distribution, you can make a statement about how much data got explained away by the model. And this is exactly what the explained variance is. And we can calculate here explicitly and say the residuals are, let's use the fit object to predict the new data again, of data x minus data y, this is the residuals, and then we can use a formula and we get this value 0.97, and if we see what stats models calculated, it is exactly the same. So we can say by this, okay, 97% of the variance got explained away by the model. And this is like very good. If you get results like this, then you probably found the right model and a strong effect of something, because you can almost completely explain the data by using the model. Okay. So the next we will look at measures of confidence, or yeah, of uncertainty. So how much how certain or uncertain we are about the parameters that we found. And standard measures for these in classical frequentist statistics are standard error and confidence intervals. And usually you get some formulas of how to compute them, but we will now look at computational ways to find the values for them, and by using this also better understand how to interpret them. So, and first, before we talk about standard error and confidence intervals, we need to introduce a new concept called the sampling distribution. So what is the sampling distribution? So the sampling distribution is a distribution of a statistic that you calculate on samples from a population. So this distribution is subject to this famous central limit theorem. So you might have heard of it, like if you just collect enough samples, then everything becomes normal. So this is what the central limit theorem says. However, this really just applies to the sampling distribution. It does not apply to all distributions. So not if you like draw infinitely many samples from a Poisson distribution, it will not become normal at some point. But if you repeatedly calculate a statistic on the sample, so if you always calculate the mean of the sample drawn from the Poisson distribution, then the distribution of these means will become normal. So this is what it says, and we will see how to use it. So just in general, how can we draw random samples from a distribution? We can use SciPy in this case, the stats module here, and we instantiate a distribution using stats.norm. This just by default has mean 0 and standard deviation 1. And then we can call the RVS method, which stands for random values, and say how many random values we want from this distribution. Okay, this is easy. So now we will try to generate a sampling distribution for this normal distribution here. So we now make a slightly different distribution with the mean at 10 and a variance of 2. And then we say, okay, we want to collect 1,000 samples. And for each sample, we will draw 20 values from the distribution. And then we just make an empty list to collect those values. And then we say, like, for each number of samples, we draw as many random values from the distribution as we said here, so each time 20. Then we calculate the mean of these 20 values, and then we really just collect the mean of these values. And this is our sampling distribution. So now if we plot this, we see, okay, these are all now different means that we got by repeatedly sampling from the same distribution. And we see here the mean of means is really at 10. This is what we put in the distribution here. But we also see that measuring, like a lot of measurements, didn't really hit this value. So this is like the same process that that you would get when you do a statistical experiment. Let's say you do some, I don't know, EEG experiment, and now you want to make a statement about like the population, which is like all humans, so to say. But you cannot measure all humans, you can just measure 20. So this is already a lot. You probably need a lot of VP hours and cookies to give to people to get this number of participants, but then you just measure 20 of them. And now you could say, okay, the real mean of the population is probably a 10, whatever you measure here, but by accident you just got a bad sample and the mean that you measured was here. And so the error that you get because you cannot measure the whole population but just a very small subset of the entire population is called the sampling error. And this sampling error is also what these measures of uncertainty like standard error and confidence interval try to quantify in some sense. So we now, so in the best case, you would, if you could, you could just repeatedly sample or like do more and more experiments and measure each time, and then you would get different means, and then you could maybe make a statement. But for now, let's just focus on this case where we have access to the population, so to say, which is our distribution. We can just repeat it infinitely often from it. It's just like random value generation. And now let's try to quantify these measures here. This is what we will do later, but for now, so like if we do it just in this computational setting, we have access to the population. So in this case, you would just repeatedly sample from the whole from the whole population.
Okay.
So obviously, in the real world, you cannot do this because otherwise, you could just do it and save this whole stuff about uncertainty, but. There's also a way to generate a sampling distribution based just on a single sample, but we will look at this like in a bit. So for now, just like given the easy case where we can sample from the real population, but what we cannot do is make working projectors. Again, same procedure. I will just continue here. So we will now try to calculate these measures of uncertainty, and we will calculate them based on the sampling distribution. So first the standard error, which is in fact just the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. So and given that we have the sampling distribution, we can just calculate the standard deviation, and this gives us a standard error. And the standard error says as much as how much we expect to be off on average when we redo our experiment. So given that we made an experiment with 20 participants, and now if we think, okay, if we would do a new experiment with 20 participants, given that we could calculate standard error before, this is why on average the new mean that we would calculate in this other sample would deviate by the standard error. So obviously, like having a small standard error is a nice thing because then you can be very certain about your parameters. And we calculate this here, and then we make a plot of it. So where we say, okay, we put the mean in the middle as a huge bar, and then we put the standard error. Interval based on the sampling distribution. So we have a function here for computing this, and this is simply computed as the percentiles of the sampling distribution. So so what we do in the function here, we first make sure that our sampling distribution is a NumPy array. Okay, not very exciting. Then we also pass a size. How big do we want our confidence interval to be? Let's say 95%. So we say on the left, we therefore need 100 minus the size divided by 2. And then on the right, we just have the size plus 2. So we would have like 2.5 on the left and 97.5 on the right. So and then the entire size of the confidence interval would be 95. And then we use the percentile function from NumPy here to get the left and the right percentiles. And right, the percentile is just the, like, how far do I need to go to get this much mass or probability mass from my distribution. So yeah, maybe trying to illustrate this percentile thing again. So if you have like a normal distribution like this, and then you say, okay, I want to get the 2.5 percentile, which also like 2.5 quantile maybe, because it doesn't make sense to say percentile here. Then you would say, okay, this, if I look at this mass compared to this mass, if this is like 2.5% of the entire mass or the probability mass, then this is my 2.5 quantile, let's say. Now if I go to the 97.5 quantile, I would go on and say, okay, now this entire mass up to here makes up 97.5% of my entire mass, so here is my 97.5 quantile. So this is just like the idea, and so basically just have to integrate over your probability distribution. NumPy does this for us here, and so we can just compute the confidence intervals like this. And so we say, okay, we say, yeah, we believe that 95% of the times, if we remeasure the mean, it will be somewhere between 9.15 and 10.89. And we can also add this to our plot and have the confidence interval boundaries here in blue. And this now shows us, okay, most of the time, really the parameters that we measured were in this confidence interval, probably like 95% of the times. Okay, let's get to the next exercise, which would be to calculate the standard error and the confidence intervals for the mean of the normal distribution with mean 10 and scale 1. And so the question, so before we had scale 2, now we have scale 1, or like variance 1, and also standard deviation. So the question would be, how does the smaller variance of the measured distribution influence the measures of sampling error? So both standard error and confidence intervals. Yeah. You just try it, and you can also say something if you feel bored or are done earlier. Okay, so what were your results?
Yes. I got a standard error of 0.223 and a confidence interval from 9.56 to 10.44.
Yeah, and this looks like similar to what I got here. Cool. So what would you say, like, in comparison to the example above where we had a normal distribution with a larger variance, how did the measures change?
The standard error was smaller, as well as the confidence interval also.
Yeah, exactly. So this means that, which also makes kind of sense, if our underlying population has less variance, then also if we do the same experiment, we would get less variance in our experiment, so we can in turn be more confident in our parameters and, like, be less uncertain in our parameters that we measured there, because we just didn't get so much variance in our experiments. So yeah, now next up we come to, so as you already said, it is a bit unrealistic to assume that we have access to the underlying population, because if we had access to the underlying population, we wouldn't need to do all this business where we have, like, could draw small samples, and so we would just measure and draw infinite many measures and would converge to one value in the end. So in the real world, we get only one sample. However, still, there's a technique called bootstrapping that allows us to generate a sampling distribution just based on a single sample. And this idea is like a general concept of resampling. And this is illustrated here. So you start with your single sample that you got from your data. And from this single sample, you generate a model of the population. And once you have this model of the population, you can generate many simulated samples. And then you calculate the sample statistics. So for example, the mean, both for the data and the simulated data. And, like, all the sample statistics of the simulated data will generate the sampling distribution. And from this, you can then, just as we did before, calculate your standard error and your confidence intervals. So what is the way to build the model of the population? Well, in bootstrapping, it is very simple, just drawing with replacement from the sample as long as you have the same number of values that you had in the original sample. So let's see. Don't really have an illustration for this, but I mean, like, drawing with replacement is probably not too hard to understand. You have, like, your original values from the sample, then you just, like, reach in, draw one value, put it in the simulated sample, and at the same time also put it back, so next time you have equal probability again as you had before. And so this means that obviously in the simulated data, the case will occur that you have the data point that you only had here once, multiple times, and data point that you have here not at all. However, this somehow generates a valid model from the population that allows us to generate such a sampling distribution. So we will now check this approach. Again, we look at the summary here, and we look at our slope, and we see that we also here have a standard error and some confidence intervals for the 95% confidence interval. And we will now think of a way to get a sampling distribution based on bootstrapping for this. So we write a function, get sampling distribution. We just make some space for samples, and we say, okay, for each number of samples that we want to draw, we need to resample our data. So conveniently, pandas provides a function called sample, and we say how many samples we want to draw from the data, where we want to draw as many as we had originally. So we just say lambda data. Then we also say replace true, so we draw with replacement and don't exhaust our original data. And what we then do is we simply the same formula or the same model to the resample data, and then we collect as a sample the params of the parameter that we are interested in. So in this case, we say we want to fit again y against x and collect the values for the slope, so that is x. So we do this, and this runs for some times because, okay, we now have to fit 1,000 linear regression. But then we can just plot the distribution of this. So this is now our distribution of slopes. So we know that originally our original parameter was 2, right? But this is how our sampling distribution looks. So the mean of the sampling distribution is not totally at 2, but still we got a sampling distribution, now a distribution of slopes. And then we can just calculate the standard deviation of the sampling distribution and the confidence interval based on the sampling distribution as before. And if we compare this with the values in that we got from stats models, we see, okay, here it is the same values for the same standard error, and also the confidence interval, like it is not exactly the same value, but almost really the same value as we got here. So we know now bootstrapping is like a valid way to generate a sampling distribution, and also a way to understand these parameters. Okay, so for the next exercise, try to recalculate the standard error and the 95% confidence intervals of the regression that we did initially of this tip versus the bi-total bill, and try to see if you can also replicate these parameters that we have in our tips fit, or if the values look a bit different. Finished. Okay, so what was your result?
0.011, which is a bit off to the lowest, to the big standard error, but not too far.
Yeah. Exactly, so what we see is the parameters are close, but the standard error and the confidence intervals are a bit larger than what stats models gave us. So we will come back to this. However, for now we will first talk about our third way of interpreting your results. So after effect size and then these measures of uncertainty, we will now come to hypothesis testing, or more general, not least null hypothesis testing. So this is, as I said, is often very important when you write, when you investigate something. People are looking at the p-value, and as I already said, this can lead to many bad results because you might just be too focused on the p-value but don't look at these more interpretable and more important things like effect size, is the effect significant at all, and how sure am I, and it is not like a, probably not a binary decision of whether you want to accept something, but still you need to know how to do it, and you should also be able to interpret it. So there are often different views on what a PL value actually is, but we will adopt the view here to say that a p-value tells us how likely it is that a result occurred only by chance. So the question is, what is then chance? Chance again is here something that just corrects for the sampling error and not other sources of error. So what you should also be, what you should also have in mind, that the sampling error just by not being able to sample the whole population is probably not the biggest error. If, let's say, you make an experiment, but you only make it on cognitive science students, and then probably the sampling bias is much worse than that what you get by just having the sampling error. So just because your p-value tells something, it doesn't mean that it's like totally correct, and also not the other way around. If your p-value is not small enough, probably there's still an effect. However, there's like statistics often seems like it's only the right, like you only have to know the right test for the right situation, and then you can do statistics. And there are a lot of different tests, like there's a t-test, an f-test, a chi-square test, a Kruskal-Wallis test, a Mann-Whitney test, and then the list goes on and on. However, if you really understand what a significance test is, you will understand that there are not really this many different tests, but there's only like always a single same procedure that you do regardless of what data situation you have or what distribution you assume. So in this general scheme of doing null hypothesis testing is illustrated here. So again, we start with the sample that we got, that we measured, that we has this, that is our data, and then we have a model of our null hypothesis, and the null hypothesis we term H0, and we need a model of it because we need to simulate data from it. And again, we can simulate samples from this model, and then we calculate our test statistic both on the data and the simulated data. And then what we do is we look at the distribution of the test statistic for the null, for the simulated data, which we have a lot of. So say we calculate the mean of each sample, then we get a distribution of means. And then we compare this to the value that we got on the observed sample. So this is illustrated here as delta star. This is the observed effect. So say this is our distribution of simulated means, and our observed mean is somewhere here. So then all the mass of the distribution that is to say beyond the observed effect makes up the p-value. So because we say, okay, if our data doesn't come from the null hypothesis but comes from the real hypothesis, which is an H1, so to say, so if our data comes also from this distribution here, then we would say, okay, our observed effect would also be somewhere here, and we would get a lot of values that are just bigger than the observed effect just by looking at the same model of the null hypothesis. However, if our observed effect is not from the null hypothesis, then we would probably have it that our observed effect is like somewhere here, and there are only like by chance just a very few values that have a bigger effect. So this is really the interpretation of a p-value that I hope is more intuitive than what you usually hear. So, and again, in text form, what we have to do to calculate a p-value just using computational tools, we construct a computational model of the null hypothesis, then we sample from that model sufficiently many samples, then we calculate the test statistic for each of those samples, and then we just calculate the percentage of the statistic being equal or stronger than the statistic calculated on the experimental data or the observed data. And this is really our p-value. So here we will look at the p-value of the slope of our linear fit that we got. So, and now we have to think about what would be a good model for the null hypothesis, what would be a null hypothesis for having like against the linear model. And this would be that, so we assume that there is a relationship between x and y, and the null hypothesis would be there's no relationship between x and y. So you get any y value regardless of where you are on the x axis, so to say. And how can we construct this from our sample? So what would be then a good model is to say we just randomly shuffle only the y values but not the x values. And if there was any relationship between x and y, then this would definitely destroy the relationship between x and y. However, if there is no relationship, then the data should just look more or less the same as it did before. So so if the null hypothesis is true, this should make no difference on the resulting slope that we get from the linear fit. So again, we have a similar function as before here. We say, okay, reserve some space for the test statistic here, samples, then copy the data and only the parameters of interest or the columns of interest, and then for each iteration just shuffle only the endogenous variables, so shuffle only y but leave x as it is. So this random shuffle function just shuffles in place, so we don't care about the return value here, and then we just fit a linear model using the formula on the shuffled data and we collect the parameter. So we then use a function like this, say we want to fit x against y, commute y, and then collect the parameters for x, and then we can plot this, and this is now our distribution of slopes under the null hypothesis. So given that we randomly shuffled or randomly destroyed the relation between x and y, this is what we get as a distribution for slopes, but this is what we really got when we did not, when on the real data. So looking at this plot, we don't really have to calculate the p-value. We can right away say, okay, the p-value would be probably zero because no values from the null hypothesis distribution are stronger, show a stronger effect than the observed one. And we can calculate this also explicitly. We say we make a two-sided test. So we say we take the absolute value of these slopes and we ask for all the values that are bigger or equal to the observed fitted parameter x. So doing this would do like element-wise comparison, generating an array of Boolean values, and then we can simply take the mean of it, and this will count like how many, what is the percentage of values being one, so and in fact zero, so no surprise. This is, however, not a really convincing example that this is really a valid way to calculate it, because it is just zero. So we will construct some data where this is made more explicit. So we generate value from a new linear model, but here we will make the scale, so the variance, a lot bigger. And we will call this a not so linear data, and this looks something like this. So this also comes from a linear model that has really the same structure as our model above, but because the variance is so big, you cannot really see the relationship anymore. So the noise is stronger now than the linear relationship. So then we use this for fitting. We get, okay, here's our p-value, by the way, in this table of the regression result. And this is now 0.14. So this already would be too big to still count as a valid statistical result. However, if we do now the same procedure for calculating the null hypothesis distribution, and then we plot the data, then we see kind of what we expected. So this is our distribution of slopes, and this is our observed value, and we see that a lot of values that were generated from this null hypothesis show a stronger effect than what we actually observed. And if we calculate this more formally, we get exactly the p-value that we also got from stats models here. So this now should make it more clear that this is now a valid way to generate or look at null hypothesis testing. So now the next exercise would be to now recompute the p-value of our tip versus total bill fit, also using bootstrapping and the methodology just shown. Or if there are any questions regarding the general procedure. Yes, so this is what you would like to see. I mean, if your result looks like this, then you are perfectly fine. But in case that your data properly came from the null hypothesis, which should always like state that there's no effect, so to say, then your data could look like this, and then it isn't really significant. Okay, and then here again it's a summary, so we would like to get a p-value, okay, also of zero, and then try this out if you also find the value of zero there. Given and the total bill that you pay in the restaurant. Okay. So, as I said earlier, when we do statistical modeling, we make some implicit assumptions, and we have ways to check that these assumptions actually hold and that using a certain statistical model is actually valid. So, in the case of linear regression, these assumptions all derive from the model itself, so that we say we have some linear combination of parameters and values plus some random error term that is drawn from a normal distribution of fixed size, And this leads to this assumption here, these assumptions here that can be memorized or summarized in the word line, which is convenient because it corresponds to linear regression somehow. And the first assumption is linearity of response, then we have independence of residuals, normality of residuals, and equal variance. And yeah, we will look at now at visual ways of checking these assumptions, and we can also talk about why they make sense. So the first is linearity of response, which yeah just kind of means that our relationship is in fact linear, and we can check this just by doing a so-called residual plot, which is very simply just plotting the residuals with a line drawn at zero. So this is what we do here. So again, the residuals are the difference between the predicted and the observed values. And we say if our response is linear, then the residuals should be distributed around zero. So and in this case, this is actually a sense the case. And yeah, this makes sense. If you assume like a linear model here, then also your residuals should be around zero, so that you removed all the structure from the data, and what is left is only noise. Then, okay, for all the examples, I will also show you an example of cases where this does not hold, so you get a feeling for this. So what we do here is we construct some cubed data that we, so we use our original data, but we just cube it, so then it will look like this, and on this plot we also already draw a linear regression through the data. So we can see that linear regression properly still captures a lot of variance of the data, but it doesn't really capture the underlying structure of the data. So if we now do the fit, we see we still have high explained variance and very significant parameters. But if we look at the residual plot, it looks something like this. So we see that there's still like structure left in the residuals. There's like a lot of data that is above the residuals initially, then all the residuals are below zero, and then again the residuals are above zero. So if you see something like this in your residual plot, this means that the model that you choose could not really capture the structure of the data because there's still structure left in the residuals. And then your response is not linear. So the next assumption is independence of residuals, which is basically the same as here. So this means that all your residuals should be independently drawn from from the same distribution, and the previous residual should not influence the next one. So in this case we see, well, there's probably not so much influence, just looks very random. But already here we would say that there is relationship between those residuals, right? So if you know this residual, you could say, okay, the next one will be probably below it. And to construct an even stronger example, we will look at some sine wave data here. So this is our data. Still, we can use a linear regression. It probably removes a lot of variance. In this case, still 65%. However, when looking at the residuals, we see that there's extremely strong structure in the residuals left. So if you see something like this, then linear regression is probably the wrong, or at least simple linear regression is at least the wrong model here. Then the next assumption is normality of residuals. So we say, we explicitly say our residuals or our error term should come from a normal distribution. So then again, our residuals should be normally distributed or from a Gaussian distribution. So one way to check this is simply plot histogram, density histogram of the residuals, and then overlay it with a normal distribution with mean zero and standard deviation set equal to the standard deviation of the residuals. So if this looks something like this, then it is probably okay. However, it is like a bit hard to really indicate or to really see if the distribution is not really normal, so if the tails are a bit longer or it is a bit sharper, so we would probably say everything that has a hump in the middle to us looks like a normal distribution, at least to me, to be honest. So there's a better tool for finding out whether your residuals are actually normally distributed, and this is the so-called QQ plot, which stands for quantile quantile plot. So what you do here is you compute the empirical quantiles of the residual distribution and pair them up with the theoretical quantile that would come from a theoretical normal distribution, and then you just plot a scatter plot between them. So conveniently, StatsModel provides a function here for doing the QQ plot. You pass the residuals in, you say you want to draw an extra line at 45 degrees, and the theoretical distribution should have the same standard deviation as the residuals, okay, and then you get a plot like this. So we see here are the theoretical quantiles, here they are lined up with the sample quantiles, and if those are the same and all on the straight line in the middle, then your distribution is probably normal. Yes, that's the idea. And then the last assumption is equal variance. That is also an explicit assumption that we have in the model. So if we go back up here, we said, okay, our residuals should have a fixed standard deviation or fixed variance. So afterwards, the data should have equal variance. So again, we will construct some data that doesn't have equal variance. We just make again 100 samples, but for the first 25 we use a standard deviation of 1, and then of 2, and then of 4, and then of 8, and then our data looks like this. So initially the data is very has very low variance, but as x grows, the variance gets bigger. If we look at the residual plot of this data, we see the same thing, that the residuals get bigger as x increases. And yeah, again, this is not what we say when we use a linear model. We don't have a fixed variance here. So again, it's not like the parameters that we get from the linear model are not very valid. So do we have time for the last exercise? Well, we have 2 minutes. That is a bit short, so I would actually like to do this and start with this on Thursday. So, and again, I would say we have one big point left for Thursday, so it will probably take like 20 minutes next time, and then again we can start with the homework. Or if you have any questions now, you can also come to me, but otherwise, see you on Thursday.